Yes, thank you. And this was something when I was working on the book, my editor kept saying, define it, people don't know what that means. Yeah. And you realize how much knowledge you have that you take for granted. And
right.
I think what's helpful about this book is it makes things accessible.
Yeah.
So it's not so esoteric and it's not pretentious. I think it's just, a franchise would be like, for example, House, the TV show. The franchise is that every week there's going to be a medical mystery. He's almost like Sherlock Holmes as a doctor. And the medical mystery will be solved every week. The CSI shows, the Law and Order shows, those are, the crime is the franchise. It gets introduced and solved within the hour. And you want it, which is why most TV series are either about lawyers, doctors, cops.
Yeah.
Because it gives you a natural franchise. The thing the networks are always looking for is a new franchise, mm-hmm. a new way in, you know, so it isn't just the same thing over and over.
In the book, you also handle rejection, which I thought, absolutely, and you write a thank you note because you don't know that you don't want that. I said to you, my husband, who's a film director, never close the door.
Yes, Carolyn C. Was my writing mentor. She's mm-hmm. an amazing novelist and book reviewer.
And a friend.
And friend. I got that from her. She said, if somebody sends you a rejection letter, send them a thank you note. That was really like mind-blowing to me. I hadn't thought of it that way.
Yeah, because you usually want to put them in the toilet.
Yes.
And
I've had some, and even knowing that, I've messed up. I remember one of the first TV pitch meetings mm-hmm. I got was on a show on HBO called Dream On. I don't know if you remember, but I went in and I had, I think, maybe 10 ideas I was pitching for episode ideas. I was trying to get a freelance episode. And I didn't realize that they shot that show in the valley, in Van Nuys, in a warehouse. So I came in, and before I pitched, I was talking to the producers, and mm-hmm. I said, I didn't realize you guys shot here. And they said, well, you know, after your meeting, if you'd like, we can show you around. We'll show you the sets. You can hang out. Well, I pitched one idea after the other, and they shot each one down.
Yeah.
And in some cases, it was almost like I could barely even get the full sentence out. And they go, no, we've already done that, or no, we don't want to do that.
Yeah.
And I felt so humiliated by the end of the pitch that I wanted to just go cry. And so I finished, and they said, well, you know, thank you. Mm-hmm. There were a lot of good ideas just for one reason or another, not working. But would you like us to come show, we'll show you around. And I said, no, I have to go. And I shot myself in the foot.
Yeah.
Big mistake.
But speaking of the fact they were shooting there, you answer two in 101, and I'm not sure the number, but if you have a choice between shooting on location mm-hmm. or shooting inside with, you know, like mm-hmm. a Universal Street mm-hmm. or something, what are the options?
Well, I worked on one TV series where we had no studio. It was all location. And I learned firsthand when you don't have control. You know, we shot once where we scouted the location and it was perfect. What we didn't know is there was a flight school nearby that operated during the hours we were shooting. And so every time we'd start to go, you'd hear plane noise.
Yeah.
Couldn't use it. We had to buy out the flight school for the day just to get them to stop. So when you're outside on location, the advantages obviously mm-hmm. is you're getting the grittiness of the real place. You know, you can take advantage of architecture and, you know, it's just much more real and immediate. When you're in a studio, you just have total control.
Yeah.
You can move walls around. You could be shooting this direction and then you could take the wall out and shoot this way. If you're shooting in a house, you're limited.
Another factor to shooting that the sort of the novice doesn't realize the importance, and they are expensive, lenses.
Yes. Yeah. Hopefully you'll have a great DP, which is director of photography,
mm-hmm.
Or cinematographer, they're synonyms.
But what if you're both, this is your first picture, you're going to be writer, producer, director?
You've got to have a great team, you know, it takes a village, you know. Film is extremely collaborative, so lenses would not be my expertise, but what I could know is working with the director, what's the look we want to get for the film. I went to see Lee Daniels, who directed Precious, the film. He was nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah.
He was talking about how He had to fire his DP after the first week of shooting because, in Lee's words, and this was at a symposium, so I'm not sharing trade secrets, he said the DP was going to ruin his movie. They didn't have the same vision of the movie.
Yeah.
The DP wanted... did you see Precious? Have you seen the movie
yet? I've seen it, yeah.
Well, the DP wanted the whole movie to be very gritty throughout.
Yeah.
Lee Daniels' vision of the movie was it would have three very different looks. When Precious was at home, it would be very gritty and dark. But when she was at the school, it would be shot in really warm tones and everything would be very pastel. He wanted it to feel safe.
Yeah.
The way he put it was, ain't nothing gonna happen to her here. And then there were the fantasies, which were shot with really bright colors and different lenses to make it.
Yeah, primal colors.
Yeah, and so there's an example of how, you know, it can help make the whole look of the movie.
But I'm amazed because the hardest thing to do for most directors is to fire somebody on the set.
Yeah.
I think the only one I ever heard of was Sam, who was such a character, but he would fire people left and right.
You mean Sam Peckinpah?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's different points of view. I know, like, Gary Ross, who directed Dave and Pleasantville, he talks, well, he didn't direct Dave, actually, he wrote Dave. He directed Pleasantville, and he talked about you have to think of your movie as, you know, like you hear about the mother who was able to lift the car off the child to save the kid. He's like, when your movie's being made, you'll do anything to protect the movie because it's posterity.
Now, we've written the screenplay, and as you say, it's one.